and we'll be talking about the future of television now. And we've got a great moderator. She's been with DMexico for quite a while. She's moderated many panels. She's probably one of the most energetic moderators, female moderators, that we have here on stage. She's coming from New York. She's brilliant. And she knows what she's talking about when she's talking about the TV and the broadcasters and the media world. Please welcome on stage Ms. Ashley Schwartz.
Oh, you're good.
You love that. I knew that.
Guten Tag, meine Damen und Herren. Meine Name ist Ashley Schwartz von Furious Corp. Ich verstehe, dass wir haben einen Catwalk und ich muss das benutzen. So, welcome. We're almost to the tail end, so thank you for staying with us. I had a conversation with Frank and Christian. I've had the good fortune of being here for the last 4 or 5 years. We had a conversation over lunch in New York where I took them to my favorite dive bar and said, we need to talk about broadcast because traditional media's disruption, specifically for television, is very different from that of print and other folks that have been disrupted by the growth of digital media. And so today we're going to talk about broadcast with some individuals that have incredible pedigree in this state. So let's start by welcoming Krishan Bhatia of NBC Universal on stage, please. Benjamin Face of Google. And Arun Kumar of Cadreon. Gentlemen, welcome. So let's just level set, because in our industry, it's a world of TLAs, three-letter acronyms, right? So we're going to do our best, and translation in a global conference in a setting like this is always a challenge. So we're going to do our best to contextualize so we have a global purview, and also so that we don't get mired in the language of our industry. So let's just level set and say that advanced television is just the use of any data or technology to help media perform better, to deliver greater return on investment on spend for advertisers and broadcasters. So I want to start really quickly, though, and just, gentlemen, give me one sentence. Tell me what your mandate is and what your remit is at your job and your role and where you're located.
So I run Cadreon globally. I'm located in New York. And my purview is to develop the tech and data infrastructure for media brands so that we leverage the best of the programmatic ecosystem.
Benjamin?
Hi, I'm based in London and I manage for Google our partnerships team. And so my job is basically to provide broadcaster publishers with monetization solutions.
Krishan?
Thanks for having me. I work in New York for NBC Universal, which is the media division of Comcast. And I manage our business operations and strategy function for advertising sales for the entire company, which includes purview over our digital business, as well as advanced advertising capabilities that we're now bringing to television.
Okay. So I'm going to start with Arun, but this, you know, all these questions, gentlemen, are jump balls. Arun, I would love for you just to give me, by region, right, North America, Latin America, EMEA, Africa, and Asia, give me a warm, hot, cold. What's the state of advanced television?
So I would say that, relatively speaking, North America, if you include the US, is hot. I would say Canada is warm. There are two or three tests that are beginning to run with some broadcasters. I think in Latin America, it was cold, but in a couple of countries like Brazil and Mexico, there is interest from the local broadcasters, so it can become warm pretty quickly. In EMEA, actually, the level of targeting that exists, especially with someone like Sky in the UK, is actually pretty advanced. And so I would say that some of these markets are warm to hot, especially markets like France and Germany are starting to show interest. Having said that, I would also caveat that by saying it's going to take between 6 months to a year before it sort of starts to tilt. In Asia Pacific, I think the most interesting market is China, where some of the cable providers have come up with some interesting solutions. It'll take some time for them to fully bake that into solutions that agencies and advertisers can use. And I think Australia has just started its first trials with MCN, so that's now become a warm to hot market. I think pretty much the rest of the world is still in the cold zone. I think you can add more color on EMEA, I think.
No, I think I agree with you on EMEA. We see, I think there's a big spectrum with a very advanced player like Sky and their smart ad product. At the same time, EMEA is not yet one single market, and so all the complexity in terms of standard measurement, etc., will take a lot more time. So we see the market heating up with more and more broadcasters really paying attention to what it means for their business. But I think it's going to take a bit more time than in the US.
So before we deep dive, I just recently finished reading a book. I was actually, Krishan and I were talking about it in the green room. It's called Television is the New Television. And I just, to sort of give context or kick off our conversation, I'm going to read a very profound sort of statement that that was made in the book. This is a book about when the smartest people in the room decide something is inevitable and it does not come to pass. Omens have been misread, tea leaves misinterpreted. Not only has the web not destroyed television, but the source of new media strength, attracting ever more traffic, truly phenomenal traffic, may in fact become its greatest weakness. So there's an interesting juxtaposition in that, right? Because this idea of the migration of audiences to new media platforms and the sort of the desire to make television more like digital media, more addressable, more targetable. The interesting part of it is that with the deployment of technology and the use of data, and the lack of liquidity or lack of supply of video holistically, the business of it is more like television, right? So despite the fact that audiences are moving, it's still premium content that wins, it's still supply constrained, and the question is where does the long tail economics pan out? That's really what matters, right? Krishan, I would love for you to sort of like take that and, you know, because I think the long tail economics are the most interesting and the most important part of the conversation.
Yeah, just to comment on that quote, I think, you know, generally I agree with 80% of it. I just wouldn't say that it's actually turning it into a weakness. I think it is a inherently more challenging and complex environment when you have proliferation of new platforms and therefore fragmentation of viewership, which I think at this point is undeniable. So it makes it inherently more challenging and complex to re-aggregate that into solutions that simplify how brands and marketers reach audiences at scale. That's most of what my teams and me personally are working on. So I actually think that while it creates a challenge, it creates a significant strength because now we have the ability to marry the best of both worlds, which we've talked about for a long time. The power of television as a medium, both in terms of content, but potentially also in terms of its display device, with the capabilities that digital brings to bear that I think stand in and of themselves with how digital is procured today, but still fail to be married in sight, sound, and motion for storytelling purposes and building great brands. And that's really our strategy, is to both bring television content to digital platforms where we can do that, and then conversely, bring digital capabilities to the television, and I've actually set up my entire organization basically around those two strategies.
So Benjamin, what are you hearing from, you know, you're really focused, as you said, sort of on broadcasters, right? And in trying to service them specifically in developing, you know, a monetization strategy for their digital video, at least the distribution over digital platforms, what are you hearing? What's the biggest heartburn? What's fear? It's a time of FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt, right? What's driving a lot of that?
Well, I think fragmentation is definitely a big issue for them. But it has been, arguably, for TV for quite some time. No? When we move from the 3 channels to the 500 channels, if you talk to a lot of the zero-rated channels, they think that there's a problem also with the system. Now, with the catch-up consumption of their TV, with the viewership on their mobile, it's a bit of a mixed feelings because, on one hand, consumption of entertainment has never been so high. We estimate that we have added about 2 hours a day of consumption of entertainment, so that's good news. It's more content being consumed, more opportunity for brands to reach the consumers. But it's incredibly hard to aggregate those audience and recreate this mass effect that TV is so good at. And I think we need to be very careful of still keeping that strength of TV. When you put an ad on a primetime show, it shifts unit because it reaches a lot of audience. And recreating that mass is important. So we can do it probably more precisely with the usage of data. But there's also another good medium to do a specific one-to-one targeting. TV has this additional element of sight, sound, and motion, of big screen that has an even bigger impact, I think, on the emotions of people.
So I'm curious, you know, is your perspective that, you know, we talk a lot about, like, one audience, one price, right? One CPM, okay? So is your perspective from the buy side, having now this arsenal of data, if you look at it holistically, you know, let's take a program like Big Brother that is universal, that's multinational, that's global, right? So I want to reach the Big Brother audience. Let's assume I specifically, ideally, would like to reach 18 to 34-year-old men that are buying a car, right? Are you better served to place your money to reach that audience, ideally to fish with a net, if you will, one audience, one price, getting as close to it or approximation of it as you can? Or is it better to say, okay, look, I know what I can do on TV and traditional media, and then what I'm gonna do is maximize what I can do on these channels that are addressable, and then start to fish with a line by using data to target and address and deliver more specifically there? What if you have to make that business decision, which is gonna deliver the greatest value, and what's gonna cost you more for your client?
So if the objective is to drive down the cost per outcome for the client, so you're looking at, what am I paying in order to move that unit?
That's a very interesting set of optics because yes. I was dovetailing off of what Benjamin said, and let's make the optics driving upper funnel brand metrics, okay, like purchase intent or recall.
Sure. So I would go for option two,
okay,
just simply because what tends to happen is, if you look at the last 50 to 100 GRPs in any TV plan and in any linear TV
GRPs plan. Are gross rating points, right? So looking at an audience and how much of a percentage of a total viewing audience tunes into TV is an alternative to buying on a cost per thousand or a CPM basis. Sorry.
So if you took that and if you said that the amount of money that I'm spending on linear TV, and if I were to put that on data-driven targeting on other platforms, which might be either on cable, or for instance, even where you're using what's called over the top, where you're not using cable, but you're watching it on your iPad or you're watching it on your tablet. Even from a simple media efficiency perspective, you actually get more bang for the buck. The second thing which is important about that audience segmentation is, even the large FMCG majors who have like an 18 to 54 broad target audience, they have a lot of discrete groups within that, which have a different set of motivations and a different set of creative triggers. Not all of them are one and the same. So what this allows me to do is play around with different creative messages to these different groups. So when we say we are going to target better, it's not that I'm trying to narrow cast. I'm still trying to reach all these people.
And message better.
But I'm trying to message better. I'm trying to understand them better. And I may not be reaching all of them on linear TV because many of them are light TV viewers and very heavy on digital platforms. So by increasing the amount of coverage that I get on linear TV beyond a point, I am not going to penetrate that audience.
Okay, so let me ask you what the incremental lift is. Let's assume we're buying on a cost per thousand basis uniformly. We're backing into that for the linear buy.
Sure.
What's the incremental lift as a percentage in a cost per thousand basis for the targeting on that digital buy relative to the TV buy? Like, how much more am I gonna pay for the use of the data to target third-party data sets, et cetera, to get, and just back the napkin, like, just tell me what incrementally you think. Is it 5%, is it 10%?
I would actually say that whenever we've used data, despite the data cost, if you look at CPMs, they've probably been either similar or they're about 5% more expensive.
Okay.
But where there has been an impact is the cost per incremental reach. So the amount that I'm paying for every incremental reach point that I'm getting against that audience
right. Is
actually dropped by 15 to 20%.
Okay. So, but the issue is that 5% lift still isn't going into Krishan's pocket, right? that's going into a third party's pocket because you're paying for the data to address it.
Let's talk about that for a second. It is going into Krishan's pocket too, which you'll speak about.
I think your prior question was the right one, and I think historically what we have seen is a relatively fragmented and siloed way of buy-side and sell-side interacting in the general television and digital converged space. And I think for good reasons, because you need to drive specialization and you need to drive data and technology-informed media buying in different ways than you might have in the past, and that requires different talent, so that's created different groups, et cetera. What we're finding, though, now is that when Cadreon, Magna IPG, and Comcast NBC Universal get together and we talk about a partnership, we're bringing all of those groups to bear. And there may be different clients, there may be different brands, they might have different objectives, and therefore we might have different solutions and products that are all priced differently. But the partnership aspect of how can we, you know, one, make it simpler for us to interact, and two, make the business better for our clients is absolutely there. We can't do that with everyone. Arun happens to be part of our closer partnership circle. And we do a lot of work with them in the traditional sense, in the sponsorship and integration sense, in the digital programmatic space, in the advanced TV space. And when you bring all of those different levers to bear and you work together to experiment what works and what drives, you know, cost per incremental reach point down and actually creates but more value for the client and for both of us, that's the winning moment. So I think the challenge for smaller players in the industry is going to be increasingly being able to measure up to that expectation of partnership, which is where bigger companies can, I think, play a role, both on the buy side and on the sell side. And I wouldn't be surprised if companies like ourselves are going to start, you know, representing a lot more audience and inventory than we might own and operate in the future.
Are we foreshadowing, or that was just?
No, that's okay. I think, an industry outlook from my perspective.
Okay.
And you're seeing that in the digital space already, and you're seeing it, I think, more so in Europe than you are in the U.S.
Of course.
So I think all of those factors are pointing in that direction.
Do you think there'll be a sales house construct of some sort in the U.S. and then in the future?
I think there could be. I think you're just, in all industries, you see it even with my parent company in cable, we've invested in the video business with a platform called X1, that not a lot of smaller cable operators can create. And this is basically an operating system for video consumption on the set-top box. And we are now a licensor of that platform to smaller cable companies in the U.S. because they can't make those capital investments.
It's true. I mean,
and it's good for the entire industry because it actually makes the video industry healthier.
I mean, and the consolidation is universal with ProSieben.
Correct.
You know, here, like, bigger is of the moment, right? So consolidation is not just within the U.S. We see it in European markets, and then there's still sort of the temples, which are Google, Facebook, etc. But it's creating a sense of fear, right? And I think one of the things, so Benjamin, I would love to hear from you, because, you know, there's consolidation through acquisition, but although we may have one player like yourself that delivers an integrated end-to-end stack, right? And you're trying to proliferate so that you can serve digital, you can serve all of mobile as much as, you know, you can without operating system carve-outs, television, or at least over-the-top or TV everywhere environments, right? Which is what your MDialog acquisition allows you to do, dynamic in-stream insertion on mobile. The reality is, though, what's the point where the greater value that we derive in performance or incremental revenue, the cost of servicing the business is just becoming so intense that the profitability of the business starts to become compromised? Like, where's the efficiency, you know, conversation with your broadcast customers?
Yeah, I think that's the real question. TV is extremely efficient to buy right now. The friction in the system is very little, whereas online and programmatic specifically is, unfortunately, not that efficient. There can be up to 50% friction, and that's not sustainable for the future of TV. So I think that's one of the investment, the idea of having trying to work to create a standard, to create a single stack that makes it more efficient, to increase the efficacy also of the system. That's what we're trying to invest into. But right now, at the stage of today, a broadcaster will try to sell their linear TV, their catch-up TV, their inventory online, their inventory on YouTube. And they're going to use four different systems, and they're not going to have the data to sell to their advertisers. So I mean, it's becoming very, very inefficient for even today, let alone tomorrow, when all of that TV is actually consumed through an IP, and where you can sell the spot on an impressions per impressions basis.
Arun, at Cadreon right now, what are the top three jobs that you need filled right now? What are those job descriptions?
So the first one would be, so I would fill all the three with data analysts.
Okay.
But when I say data analysts, I'm talking about people who are able to understand how disparate data sets that come from different sources. They may come from the digital area, they may come from the programmatic area. How do we sync that to offline data? And how am I able to create...
So you want magicians.
Effectively.
Right. I feel like you should have a wizard should be on that job.
We've started producing some magic, so it's not that impossible. Every magician has a trick. So there are ways of doing it, but where we really have a challenge is in scaling that. So we've built the platforms that will be able to do it, but to scale that, we need talent that's able to understand and interpret that.
Okay, so I just want to carry this forward for a minute. So how much, what's the salary range of a middle level, you know, I've 5 to 10 years experience data analyst?
Which market?
US.
Well, so it can be anywhere.
I'm looking for a delta, not an absolute number. So just throw it out there.
So it's delta on top of?
Just tell me, what's the middle salary range?
So it'll be somewhere from, if you're talking about someone about 5 years.
Yeah.
It could be about $70,000 to $80,000.
78K. And a media planner with 5 years experience.
Probably get about 50, 60.
Okay, so that's like a 30% delta in cost of talent, right? Krishan, what's the long tail on the business? If you have operational overhead that in a steady state, your OPEX is 30% more, if you are able to do, which what you've told me you've accomplished, is create parity of 1 hour of viewing on linear versus digital, you can retain and sustain your revenue levels in advertising. What's that incremental 30% in OPEX do to you?
So it's a great question if I understand it correctly, and it's a question I get asked all the time. And it's one of scale in terms of how you actually drive efficiency versus cutting cost in a medium where I believe we should be continuing to invest in. And it's one of pivoting the resource allocation. So a traditional media company has generally been in advertising sales, set up around salespeople and back office support. And sales, you know, is compensated at a significantly higher level than anyone that would be considered back office support. In the new model, I actually believe that we will be pivoting the balance between sales and what might have been called back office, but really is forward-facing product, operations, technology, analytics, yield, et cetera. And those resources, in our case, might actually still be more efficient, meaning less compensated than traditional sellers, but we'll have a different ratio. Generally speaking, we might have a 2-to-1 ratio of support to sales today. I actually believe, you know, it should be double that, because you will create something of scale that you can now take to market with arguably a more senior and a more solutions-oriented sales team that is supported by subject matter expertise and technology in the background, or in the foreground for that matter. That's a huge shift. I'm not sure whether it's the same in Europe, but in the US it's a huge shift in terms of the business model of advertising sales that I think many of our peer companies are wrestling with and that we're trying to lead, and where we have taken initial steps towards that, like in the programmatic space, it is definitely paying off in spades. I can now have a traditional sales team go to market and talk about programmatic offerings with Arun's teams that they would have never had been able to, and I might only have 5 or 10 people, you know, from a subject matter expertise supporting that, creating significant growth opportunities for us as a company. So
right.
that pivot is a big organizational and talent and recruitment and development, I think, challenge and opportunity that we're taking on.
Benjamin, do you...
So just to complement on this, There might be an even more radical scenario, though, where you could believe that machines will be able to do a lot more of the automation. Mm-hmm. And the differentiator will be the ability to understand the data. And so the parallel with the financial world is easy. But an analyst on Wall Street makes more, I think, $400,000 than 75. And that relates to the introduction, I think, that Dimexco. It's more the rise of the algorithm. How do you make a better algorithm? And I think you need more a $400,000 analyst. Yes.
See, I think this is so funny, Benjamin, because my next question to you was going to be if Google was going to build out a professional services team to help broadcasters onboard onto your stack. It's so interesting because I, from my like my perspective, I still see more dollars moving over a steak dinner and a handshake, and occasionally a strip club. Like honestly, there is programmatic. You know, I think we're moving into automation and we're trying to move as efficiently as we can because we see the cost of servicing. But do you? Yeah, I mean, is it almost like the intermediate step is we've got a handhold? In some ways,
that's I hate to go back to this thing, but I think you need the stack if you are in a world where 50% of your budget is lost and you don't know which half. So there's got to be an intuition, you've got to be serviced. There's a partnership that's important. But when you move to a world where you're able to measure a lot better the impact, even the impact on the upper funnel. Well, maybe those strip clubs are going to have less customers.
But see, the issues, the macroeconomics don't pan out. It's an illiquid market, right? We don't have enough.
Have to be.
We don't have enough premium video. So at some point, you have to have an artificial advantage, in some way, right? I mean, how much? You're still 50% direct sales, Krishan?
In what sense?
In what sense that you're not actually using a marketplace to fulfill the inventory?
So basically everything direct.
Okay.
Whether it's technology or data enabled or not, it's through a direct partnership with clients and agencies.
And a lot of that is upfront. You're pre-negotiated because it's illiquid. You want access to inventory. You need to be able to promise your brand clients you're going to have avails and inventory available for them when they want to buy and fulfill, right?
But I would draw the parallel with digital, because 4 years or 5 years ago, it was the same question, which is, are we going to get the quality of inventory to be able to go programmatic? And I think today the place has come where it's not about what percentage of that inventory is going to programmatic anymore, because what that ecosystem has done is it's made all my buys a lot smarter. That today, to me, the first question is, can I put my entire digital buy in a data-driven fashion? And maybe 30% of that is being bought programmatically.
I feel like in order to have an informed conversation, we need to separate and compartmentalize display from video. Premium video in particular, right? I mean, do you agree?
Well, yeah, but even video inventory availability is increasing. The thing is, you're looking at how much of video is available through programmatic. It doesn't matter to me. Because all I'm interested in is, am I making a more intelligent media choice on all video?
But at the end of the day, if you want to reach yogurt-eating moms, 18 to 34, and you go into your DSP, and you start with an approachable audience of 1 million, and after you apply your data segments, you have an approachable audience of 10, you do care, don't you?
No, but that's because you're saying that my way of trading is going to be through a DSP, through what programmatic is understood as, through an exchange, et cetera.
Yep.
But that's not what I understand. The way I look at it is, first of all, whom do I take to a strip club and why? And what am I seeking to achieve out of it? So if I know exactly what I'm seeking to achieve out of it, my transaction might still be taking place over a handshake, but at least it's a more informed handshake rather than just going and saying, I know you for the last 10 years, and I know that people say you're the largest channel in the US, so I'm gonna do this deal with you.
So you think, I mean, guys, I think this is where I'm sort of struggling, right? It's because
you're onto something though, if I can just add to it. I think you're absolutely right, because if you create the kind of data-driven nature of buying digital and you're buying it, to Arun's point, on an open exchange, you're not going to get the match rates and the quality, generally speaking, that you need. Where most of that quality exposure is being unlocked is actually now in direct partnerships, as I mentioned earlier, where we're not fearful of programmatic. Programmatic, to me, is great because it helps continue to validate, if not enhance, the value of premium video content, regardless of
But to be clear, you pre-negotiated price and volume commitments. Well, you're just always fulfilling it programmatically,
there's always,
right?
There's always a business negotiation and, right. and business terms around anything that you buy and sell, obviously, and that's driven by demand and supply. But so the partnership aspect is actually really important because you learn from each other about what are your respective objectives, and then maybe I can be less fearful or the buy side can be less fearful and we can actually get business done. That's increasingly happening, I think, as big media companies are embracing new technologies in order for them to make their audiences more accessible, more targetable, more data enabled, which is what we're doing. And we're seeing real traction, real growth from it. Most of our growth is coming from data enabled and technology driven media buying at this point.
Yeah, and I mean, because I guess I think, and Benjamin, this goes back to sort of like, you know, now that you guys have a more and ever increasingly integrated stack of solutions end to end, right? Display programmatic matured for a different reason, right? There was so much inventory and we had to find a way to make that inventory more valuable, right? Video, we wanted to make it more targetable and addressable, right? So I think there's, in some ways, they're kind of conflicting motivations, but what I keep coming to and I'm struggling with, and this is one of my personal professional journeys, is how we transact business, right? And we manage our P&Ls is different from how we operationalize it. But I think what we've gotten ourselves is into a position where we're using our operational systems to run our businesses. And I think feel like in order to be able to really weather the storm from a large media company perspective, there has to be slightly less gray matter, right? And they're all kind of being pushed together.
I'd like to if you look at video, online video, there's a platform out there called YouTube where over 90% of the revenue is transacted programmatically. So the video, online video market programmatically is already very high. Now, there's one thing that maybe
Tell me what you mean by programmatic, because we're not using AdX to do it. We're not using Google's marketplace.
You're using DBM, you're using AdSense. It doesn't matter which front end you use, but you use the data to buy on auction impressions per impression.
Yeah, but I wasn't questioning. I wanted the specificity because we're all using programmatic and it means different things to different people. So you're not saying we're using Google's programmatic platform. You're just saying we're using data and technology.
Yes.
Okay.
If you take, if you mentioned mDialog, let's say you have an ad break that reaches 10 million people. You have 8 ads. Today, you have to sell 8 units to 8 different advertisers. Now, if that ad break becomes addressable, you don't have 8 units to sell. You have 8 times 10 million units. That's 80 million individual impressions. You don't trade that with handshakes. If you want to maximize the yield, you have to use a lot more data-driven decision, and I think.
But then we have to go back to the conversation of quality, because tonnage.
No, but it's the same ad. It's exactly the same
ad.
I'm
not about
the quality
of not the quality of the ad unit, the quality of the adjacency of the content.
But it's the same content. It's just the same 10 million is just driven differently technologically. So there's no change, absolutely no change whatsoever in the quality. It's just a lot more tonnage suddenly that arrives at high quality. And if you want to make the most of it, you can use data not only to optimize the CPM, but to have better creative, to have more sequential advertising, for example, to stop bombarding those heavy users with always the same ads. So there's plenty that can be improved from a user's perspective also with the usage of the
But again, technology. I think to your point, you're right. And we have this philosophy where we say all TV is video, but not all video is TV, ultimately. All video doesn't lend itself to carrying either the same creative storyline or the same brand messaging, ultimately.
Yeah, or just gravitas overall, I think.
Yeah, in our case, it so happens that, you know, our content creation heritage is one of producing for the television set. That same content translates onto digital platforms. I don't know whether I shared the stat with you, but ironically, when we look at our digitally enabled inventory today, where you would say, most of that has to be on mobile platforms, and a lot of it is on mobile platforms, but actually most of it is happening on television sets again. So through the proliferation of over-the-top devices, my digital inventory is actually television inventory, and it's dynamically enabled, which is maybe what you were saying. Now I can do everything on the television set that I can't do in the core infrastructure, but I can do it through IP delivery, dynamic ad insertion. I can add any data and targeting parameters. It's ad served in the same way as if it was a desktop video view or a mobile video view or a set-top box VOD video view. So that's the power, and I think that's where the jury is still out. Are we going to change the entire plumbing of the US television infrastructure in order to make it addressable? Or is consumption going to shift to new platforms in such a rapid manner that the story is sort of going to write itself? I'm going to be able to do all of those things just because of how consumption is shifting, which is to digitally enabled platforms. Therefore, I can do almost anything I do on it, you know.
Can you express a, can you foreshadow, or that just, is there a conflict?
Well, I mean, I would just say that we have underestimated the velocity of growth on digital platforms every year for the past 3 or 4 years since we, you know, started.
Do you include
really
X1 to be one of those digital platforms?
X1 can be. X1 is a hybrid box, actually. It has, you know, it is IP for the guide and coax for the video signal. So it's still a broadcast model.
Right. It's still dual.
But
so, Arun, do you consider, let's say, so Debbie yesterday was on one of my panels, your colleague from Google, she's awesome, she's talking about Cutie Pie. So Krishan has a show that reaches the exact same audience of Cutie Pie. What would that be? A young woman, like, what would an audience of Cutie Pie be? I know you don't sell on audience, you sell on vertical, but who's the eyeball of Cutie Pie? Just describe that person to me.
Cutie Pie is probably more of a 15 to 25-year-old male.
Male, rather, sorry.
Very expensive audience on TV.
So, okay, so 18 to, no, 29-year-old male, pick a, you know, that likes toothpaste, right? Krishan's program, or buying into the entertainment vertical on YouTube, or buying reserved on a preferred partner on YouTube. Is there parity there?
Yes, there is.
CPM?
Because if Krishan gives me that same 18 to 29, then I will look at what's the content that I'm going in front of in YouTube, and whether that content has affinity to, if for example, you're talking about a millennial and they're far more likely to watch content on YouTube, even if Krishan's giving me access through a show, I'll prefer YouTube. If it is, actually there's no differential and they also watch programs on TV, I'd take Krishan.
So assuming you could use the exact same arsenal of tools to target or deliver, addressable.
I want the same definition of the audience on both platforms.
Okay, uniform, mirror, like clone of one another. You can have the same arsenal of tools, you can use your data stack and your DMP in the same way. Apples to apples, on a CPM basis, is Krishan's inventory more valuable than preferred inventory on YouTube?
Well, it depends on what the cost is going to be.
But I hope it's not the question that you ask yourself, because you should look at the audience. And there's, we've launched single source panel in many markets now. If you buy both, I'm trying to be friendly.
I know,
here.
I was about to say that. In many cases, you'd buy both. But if I had to choose.
Because it's an illiquid market, and there's not enough video inventory, right? We've come full circle.
If I had to choose, I would just simply say that I would choose the one, if everything else matches, then you're just making a simple price-based decision. Is this more expensive or is this not?
Well, I mean, yes, ideally if you're serving your customers best, it should be. But in general,
why would I not do that?
Do you not believe that there is a perception of higher value of derivative content coming off of linear programming that is distributed?
I think not.
In Europe? I think in Europe there is.
I think it comes back to scale as well. Can you deliver that on an ongoing and sustainable basis? Right, and that's where I think television compared to digital video still has a giant chasm in terms of just pure ability to deliver against those target audiences on an ongoing basis. I can deliver on it maybe once a month, you know, in any given digital video platform, but on television, the net concentration, even of younger viewerships on an ongoing basis is still much larger. And when you compare our digital platforms, just on an 18 to 49-year-old basis versus television. Television is generally less than 50% is 18 to 49. On our digital platforms, it's north of 70%. So we have much higher younger viewership concentration, obviously, on digital platforms as well. And we can deliver that on an ongoing basis. So
guys, the long tail, right? Because what we were saying, I said this on the panel yesterday, like, at the end of the day, what we all have the same of, no matter, you know, from where we are, gender or anything else, is like, it's time. We only all have 24 hours in the day. And year over year, we've seen that the net time spent with media and video consumption in particular increases, right? It's because we're multitasking, we're watching. Last question. Sorry, Martin, I didn't hear the music.
Can I sit next to you?
I just want to
get the feeling how it is, how you're doing your job.
I didn't hear the, was there music?
Come on. The music is not going on here, but there was a screen there basically showing you that you have to...
I did see it.
Here's where we use jazz hands and we deflect. So, gentlemen, I'm not going to ask you that question.
Did I promise you too much that she's the most energetic... moderator in the whole digital space. I think they've done a great job.
Thank you.
To interrupt
you. Sorry, guys.
We need to move on with the program.